This, my friends, is the poster child of Sony's earbud lineup right now, the WF-1000XM4. You've probably heard about it. And let's cut to the chase. The product is amazing, and just how amazing it is, we'll discuss in a second. So, in this episode, I'm gonna try to break this down as best as I can, and hopefully in the process, help you decide whether to skip it altogether, or whether to start writing Santa for one. And yes, I know it's only June, but in case you haven't heard, there's been a global silicon shortage, and you know, it takes time for those little elves to make one, with all the whole polar supply chain and strikes and such. You know how it works. But anyways, are you ready for this review? Let's do it after these messages. Wow, here it is, guys, in the flesh. And I'll tell you what, there's been so much anticipation for these XM4s, it's not even funny. Especially from the Sony fanboys. They just keep incessantly asking me to do, Aaron, you gotta do the XM4s, you gotta do the XM4s. We're planning to upgrade from the XM3s. It almost sounded like they were off their coffee for a whole week or something. But anyways, without wasting your time, let's talk specs real quick. Thankfully, in this case, the rumor mill was wrong about a $300 or above price, because this retails for $280 US, either for the black one or the silver one, this one. Active noise cancellation is supposedly better than ever before, with a new V1 chip running the show. There's adjustable pass-through mode just like before, plus the new speak-to-chat feature that we first saw in the WH-1000XM4 headphones. As I reported a couple of weeks ago, this has Bluetooth 5.2 on board, which potentially opens it up for Bluetooth LE for future implementation. But in the meantime, this has AAC, SBC, and get this, LDAC. Yes, LDAC support that allows you to stream your tunes at up to 990 kilobits per second via Bluetooth. Hello, FLAC files. Now, the Achilles heel of the XM3s of not being water resistant has been fixed, because now we have IPX4. It's not the best, obviously, but I'll take that. Battery life is rated at 8 hours by Sony. My time with it netted about 7.45 hours at 65% volume with ANC and adaptive sound turned on. We also have mono mode, which means you can use the earbuds individually while the other one is charging. There's also wear detection, by the way, which means when you take the earbuds out of your ear or put them back in, media will start or stop, which is nice both ways. There's also auto power off. What we don't have is multi-point Bluetooth connection, which is kind of sad to see at this time of in 2021 especially. Now I'm going to put this aside and I want to show you the packaging real quick. Now, this is the box that it came in, and besides the label that was wrapped around like so, this whole entire box and everything in it is pretty much post-consumer recyclable material, which is really nice to see. It's a small gesture, but it's welcome nonetheless. So, nicely done, Sony. Nicely done. Well, here is the new charging case, and you probably heard that Sony shrank this down quite a lot, and that be true, guys. That be true. Unfortunately, I don't have an XM3 to compare this side by side, but I have a video here of me holding the XM3 in my palm, and you can compare the XM4 and the 3. It's definitely a nice sizing down here, really, really nice. And the fact that they're able to retain the same 24-hour battery capacity and add wireless charging, that's nice. It's not the smallest case considering the size of the ear tips or earbuds itself, but it's a nice downsizing for Sony. Really, really good stuff. Now, build quality. I have a slight knock on this one. Now, look at this. You see that hinge free play right there? I'm not a fan, because even like the Amazon Echo Buds, which is pretty much half the price, doesn't have that issue. It's really, really well built. One of the better ones I've seen. But look at this. Hold on, let me see where this is made. No, not that way. Made in Malaysia. Oh yes, we have issues with the QC of Sony in Malaysia back in the day too. I've talked about this, and the QC needs to wake up. The hinge is really loose here. There's not barely a squeak when I hold this, but there is a little bit, which is passable, but this floppy play of the hinge for a $250 device, I can't accept that. But in terms of the materials though, this is a nice change from the XM3 as well. XM3 was really nice to grip and everything, but if you look closely, and I've not noticed other reviewers talk about this, I'm trying to bounce the light to see if you can see this, but it has like the quartz-like kind of speckles on it that reminds me of sandstone. It really does. It has like glittery dust on it. Really, really nice stuff. Really easy to hold as well, and it's quite a scratch-resistant surface, and also easy to clean as well. Really, really nice stuff. As for the rest of the case itself, the LED status light is right there. It glows orange or green depending on the status. There's the nice little gap right here. It's easy to open, and the hinge locks in place, by the way. Nice stuff. Back here, we have the USB USB-C charging port, and down here, as you mentioned earlier, is the Qi charging coil. Now, when we open the lid, that thankfully locks. I really like that kind of feature, unlike the Amazon Echo Buds that we looked at last week that flopped around. You're greeted by mostly matte plastics. Thank you very much. It's easy to clean. It's not, you know, it doesn't stay dirty all the time. There are some interesting cavities that I noticed, or nooks and crannies, or whatever you want to call them, up here. This black disc right there in that little hole. So I can see that they match. These holes right here match this microphone embellishment right here. And this black disc with a hole in the middle, I'm not sure if you can see that, also pairs up with the wear sensor window. So I'm not sure why that's there. And that little pinhole at the end there obviously also matches up with the ear tips. Is that a drain hole? I hope not, because if you have that kind of runny wax, ear wax, you're probably going to have to see a doctor. But it's there. If anybody knows what it is, my engineering mind is always curious about it. So if anybody knows, let me know down below. So anyways, the cavity is pretty easy to clean with the ear tip or something, except for that hole down below that's never going to be clean forever, because dirt is just and gunk is just going to gather there. Anyways, let's do the magnet test. Let's pop in the ear tip or earbud. These things are nice and strong, guys. That's a definite pass. The hinge is also a definite pass. So yeah, way to go, Sony. Well, here is the earbud. And just like the case, this has gone through a radical redesign. In fact, even more so, because gone is that old spade, old school Bluetooth headset design, and in with this more organic hearing aid kind of shape. And I really like it. Now, material choices, spot on. It's very similar to the case, very nice and grippy to hold, and has that same sandstone look as well. And the fact that this has IPX4 now, if you have sweaty fingers from working out, it's very easy to remove and insert into your ear. And earlier I forgot to mention that it's also easy to do the same from the case as well. Build quality is decent. There's an obvious seam line right there that bisects the top and the bottom, and my fingernail kind of catches it a little bit, but not too bad. And there's nary a sign of any kind of even matte plastics, unlike the case, because it's this whole sandstone look that Sony is going for. Really nice stuff. There's two microphones on board per side, which is kind of strange in this day and age, 2021, at this price range. I usually see three per side, so it's kind of daring for Sony to do this, and we'll talk about microphone quality in a second. And I believe one of the microphones is behind this gold embellishment right here. Yeah, I wish this was some kind of toggle switch, like some kind of volume toggle, spindle or whatever, or button. That would have been nice, but this whole thing is plastic. The other microphone is back here that is next to this little typical Sony left side indicator for the visually impaired. So if you're looking for this, if you're visually impaired or in the dark, you know where the left side is. Now, Amazon has also copied it nowadays, and now they've done it on the right side, so that's really cool that they're doing that. Charging pins or charging connectors are right there. The wear sensor window is right here. At the top here is the venting port, also surrounded by gold embellishment, which is very typical of the 1000X series. They always like to have a splash of gold here and there. Be whatever color you get, that's always the same gold. Now, there's a 6mm driver in here that's a little bit more compact, that allows for bigger battery, and also the V1 chip is in here, that's also a battery zipper, which allows for the 8 hours of battery life in this. That's really impressive for something of this size. In terms of the ear tip, Sony says that this is their unique polyurethane foam. And I'm not sure if it's the formulation that's special or the design or whatever it is, but when you compare it with something like the Comply foam tips, I don't see any difference in terms of performance. But what I do notice is that this doesn't get as dirty as quickly, which is really nice to have. So maybe that's it. So anyways, when I pop this open, it reveals a hardened center core, which makes things really easy when you want to reinsert it. And here is this decently long or short, depending on your point of view, sound port, and it's covered by a mesh grill to protect it from debris. Now, the touch controls are right here. This whole thing, it's very nice and sensitive, and it accepts single, double, and triple taps, as well as hold, and is decently customizable, as we'll check out in the app close-up later on.
All right, let's do this. The Bluetooth distance test. I have some Sweetness by Pantone playing on Deezer here in high fidelity. I'm going to put the phone at the end of my deck, and as many of you know, I'm just going to walk the back of my house, past line of sight to the side of my house, and we'll see when these guys start having connection issues. So the XM4s have Bluetooth 5.2. Theoretically, it should last around 30 to 33 feet before we start hearing connection issues. Wow, that's weird. Okay, so it on cue, it just dropped out. But one thing that Sony does do that compared to other ones that I've tested so far is when it loses any kind of, even just a weak signal, it just drop out completely. It doesn't give you any hope, like it won't do the sputtering stuff or anything. It just drops out. I know, it's weird, interesting. I'm gonna keep walking until we get some kind of disconnect tone or something. But this is further than what I'm used to. There you go, I got a tone. It says disconnected. All right, that's about, wow, 50 feet. Not too bad. But, you know, that's just, this is just for fun. How you guys doing? It's a beautiful day out. It's nice and cloudy. It's gonna possibly rain, I think. I can see the fit of these on my head. How do you like it? It's much better than the XM3s, right? Totally. They sit much flusher to the ear, into the ear. It does protrude out about a couple of millimeters. So some of you may or may not like it. But this is how, this is the new look, the new direction, and I like it. I'm back in range here, and Sony just told me, yes, Bluetooth connected, but media does not resume. I have to tap play, and then media resumes. So other earbuds do it automatically, but no big deal. You tap either side, it'll play. Just one tap, you know, do that. So on to the microphone test for phone calls. All right, I'm taking it down to the road right now. We'll get some sound samples. There's a big truck and a bunch of traffic coming through. So you can hear for yourself whether these XM4s are any better than the XM3s and even the competition or something that you might own right now. Yeah, I'm not a fan of these. Noise suppression, they're a notch up from the XM3s, but definitely not at the key players' level of quality. We all know that Sony's have always been notorious with just lousy mic quality, let alone noise suppression. But this V1 chip is doing a little bit better, but I'm not sure what the Sony engineers are doing.
You have a lot of competition now to compare things with. Come on, get that right.
So back to the drawing board for Sony. I have to say though, in a quiet environment, these things, they retain the voice.
My voice really well, the bass, the intonation, spot on. But when you introduce perpetual noise, no.
One thing I have to say too, one thing I really like too is when you initiate phone calls, if you're in active noise cancellation mode,
pass-through mode kicks in to give you better situational awareness. So that's a good safety feature. I would suggest turning down the
pass-through mode level though, because at level 20, which is maximum, you can hear a single car tire whine coming from like half a mile away.
And it's this high-pitched noise. So when you're having a conversation, it's
kind of weird. You probably can hear from the samples too. Right now it's kind of windy, so there is
occasional wind through the mics. So you can hear how it,
you know, how it handles wind. But
overall, nah, not noise suppression. These things.
We're now in Sony's ubiquitous headphone app. If you've used the older WF and WH devices before, the app experience is pretty much identical. What is different now, at least on Android, is when you pair these for, say, the first time or any other subsequent use, you'll notice a tight integration with Android's fast pair feature, which promises faster setup and also better and more info on your phone's notification system, even on the lock screen. But anyways, here is the home screen. The battery levels are right at the top here. So is the indicator that LDAC is on, DSE is on. If those are not available, those won't be there. And then down below that is the tab menu, the status, sound, and system. Under status, you'll find the media controls as well as adaptive sound control if you tap that. This is where the device changes how much noise cancellation to apply depending on your location or activity. And I usually leave this off because it's not the most accurate. Now, under sound, you can toggle between noise cancellation, and this is off right now because I have the earbuds out, but they're indicating that I'm not wearing it. But if I cover the wear indicators, so you can adjust here or change between noise cancelling or ambient mode, change the level there, or off. And down here, speak to chat is really useful. I really like this. And the fact that you can change whether it focuses on your voice or not, and you can even set the time or duration of when it stays on. Right now, it defaults to about 10 to 15 seconds, but the smallest is 5. But I found that if you like to sing or hum along to your music, or if you happen to be coughing a bunch, turn this off. You'll thank me later. The 5-band EQ is below that, and further down you can ask also the app under here, the 360 reality audio setup. You can ask the app to analyze your ear to optimize the fit of the earbuds. The DSE switch down here is at the bottom and it cycles between auto and off. If you want to customize your controls, that'll be under system. Left, right controls are customizable. Let me tap this gear icon so you can better see this, but only as preset packages. You can see under ambient, playback, or volume controls, those are presets rather than being customizable on an individual button tap to button tap basis. And oh yeah, this is one weird Sony quirk that if you activate any of the voice assistants, be it Alexa or Google Assistant, the left earbud won't work in mono mode. Yeah. Hoo-yah! So, are you wondering what my favorite bits of the XM4s are? Well, the first one, surprise, surprise, is the sound quality. These things, they elevate what XM3 is really good for, the warmth and the strength and just the fullness of the sound that just sounds so rich and just pushes it further with extra processing and such. And I have to say, audiophiles might be turned off to all the digital processing and such, and they might just frown on the whole shallow V or the elevated V kind of profile. But I would say for most listeners who want to be introduced into how music should be listened to, XM4s are it. These things, they sound so good. With a DSEE Extreme, for example, if you have a low bit file, it just pushes, lifts everything up, makes everything sound fuller and warmer. Just so rich. But if you're listening to a FLAC file through LDAC, oh my goodness, guys. My glasses have come off. It's just that amazing. If you're listening also streaming through Tidal and the highest quality, it's just so rich. And I don't know what it is, what voodoo that Sony does. So I read somewhere too that someone said that these earbuds are going to replace headphones. There's really no need. But one plus of the headphone is when it sits on your ear, it vibrates your earlobe and also creates then therefore staging and better spatial awareness and such. And so when I put these earbuds on, I was kind of apprehensive or just, you know, suspicious of, yeah, that can be true. But when I put these on, I'm not sure what Sony does, but it works. The staging, I can tell where the instruments are in the space around my head. It's pretty darn impressive. It's not perfect like a headphone, but it's pretty darn close. So sound quality, oh my goodness, I just can't stop gushing about this thing. Another technical achievement, but to a lesser degree I think, is the active noise cancellation system. If you compare the XM3s, which were really strong in their own right already, and compare it with the XM4s, the brand new V1 chip, the workhorse of this new one, is really doing things a lot better now. It responds a lot quicker to sudden loud noises, and it nullifies and isolates a little bit better on all the frequencies, especially low frequency rumbles of engines and such. Things are just a little bit better, so it's a marginal improvement. One of my favorite features is the speak to chat that's inherited from the WH-1000XM4 headphones. And I really like that. It activates pass-through mode when you're in active noise cancellation mode and you initiate a conversation. It takes a couple of ticks to respond or react, but once it kicks in, it activates pass-through so you can talk easily. Some people have said that the active noise cancellation is class-leading. I don't think so, because if you compare it with the Bose QC earbuds, which are really, really strong, it wins in some areas, but the Sonys also win in others. So they're kind of neck and neck, and I'll say it's a tie. So I'm not belittling Sony's achievements here, but because the XM3s were strong in their own right, but the XM4s are marginal improvement, but it's definitely not class leading though. Another one that I really appreciate, and I know you will too, is the 8-hour battery life. That's just so mega, so awesome. And the fact that they were able to do that in a smaller form factor, kudos Sony. Kudos. Now, a lot of you already know that I don't like touch controls in general, because anytime you're jamming something deeper into your ear canal, that's never good news. But I have to say something about the XM4s with the new V1 chip again. It's almost instantaneous. When I tap it between the phone and that, it's almost instantaneous. Sure, there's a little bit of a delay, but compared to other earbuds of the same price or caliber, this thing is pretty fast. So I have to give it props for that too. Well, believe it or not, the XM4s are not perfect. Far from it. And I have a couple of problems here. First one is the form factor. I appreciate that Sony shrank things down. Yes, there's no denying that. And I hope the XM5 continues that tradition. But the XM4s are still too bulky, just like the XM3. It always feels like the center of gravity is leaning towards the outside where all the componentry is. And it always applies pressure on my upper ear canal. So I can never wear this for more than an hour and a half, 2 hours before they really start hurting, which is a crying shame. That's like 1/4 of the entire 8-hour listening time. Now, I want to segue to the fit, which is the next negative. Sony includes foam tips, which is a really nice gesture. It kind of means like you bought into a really expensive device and they give you foam tips usually. But I think there's a second reason. Just like the XM3, Sony knows that the center of gravity of the unit, again, like I mentioned, it's always towards the outside. So foam tips allow it to lock in place much better than slippery silicone. So when it locks in place, the passive seal is amazing. It's really good. But when it doesn't, like say for example, when I'm listening to music with a good seal and I get a phone call and I start talking, and as you know, when the jaw moves, your ear canal changes sizes. So my ear tips always want to just pop right up, and that's never a good feeling. So I don't like the insecure feel, but when it, that being said, when it does fit, man, it's very satisfying. Locks in place, The passive seal allows the earbud to really perform. It's really, really nice. It's a very satisfying feeling putting it in and knowing that it works. It makes this really cool or funny squeaking sound when you put it in, you squeeze out the air, you pop it in. It almost sounds like a wet rubber ducky or something. But yeah, most of the time the fit, yeah, I don't feel very secure with it, unfortunately. And my biggest negative of all is Sony's naming convention. Sony naming guy, this is not our first dance for crying out loud. You know how I feel about this. I like something simple and catchy, but you know, you want something as complex as possible. It almost reminds me of Elon Musk trying to name his child. Hold on a sec. Are you Elon Musk, Sony naming guy? So here we are at my final thoughts, and I'm gonna try to keep things simple as possible. The XM4s are exemplary. I just love these things. In terms of sound quality, they're top of the class. Active noise cancellation, they're near the top or one of the best. And everything else is really, really good. One of the best battery life. And now they have IPX4 water resistance, so you can take it working out. And there's wireless charging now, and the controls or customization is one of the best. And all the features that Sony throws in, the processing of the sound, oh my goodness, I just love this for the sound quality. If you get it for that, just do it. But that being said, if you have an XM3 and you just want to upgrade based on active noise cancellation, marginal improvements, there's really no need unless you can find a good price on these. But if you're coming to this new or you just want to upgrade to the best and greatest and the best, definitely get these ones. I find these a little bit too expensive, even for my taste. But I think sales are going to come faster than they did with the XM3s. And the reason why I think that is because with the XM3s, when they first came out, there was very little competition, so Sony could afford to keep the price pretty high for a long time, the exclusivity. But with these new ones, there's a lot more competition out there launching left and right all the time. So retailers will be pressured to drop the price pretty frequently. So watch out for sales. If you can wait, it's going to be awesome. But if you can't, it's still an amazing device to get. So yeah, either way you look at it, the XM4s are just awesome. So with all that said, I want to give the Sony WF-1000XM4 a gear up score of 8.9 out of 10. And this is how I broke it down to get to the final score. If you have any questions about it, feel free to comment down below. So guys, if you like the stuff that I do and you like to see more videos like this, subscribe to this channel, smack that button like it's been naughty, and turn on the bell notification icon as well so you can join me next week for more videos. Remember to tell your friends and family about it too, and if you're financially able to, you can also visit my Patreon page down here and help me out that way and help me grow this channel. That'd be super awesome. Remember to thumbs up if you like this video as well and comment nicely down below, that's super important stuff. And remember to do something kind and loving for somebody, as I always say, because the world needs it more than ever. There's always a stranger in need, and it starts with you. So I'll see you the next time, guys. Thank you for watching this video again. I love you so much. Peace out.